Hello students, welcome in today's lecture and we are now going to start the first chapter of unit 1, the living world. In today's lecture we are going to discuss the important points from this chapter, that is what is the living organism, and then we have to study the properties of the living organism. So we start first from the definition of the living organism. Now you can identify the living organisms from the non-living organisms by number of characteristics. That means the characteristics which the living organism has, these are the respiration. Living organism can move from one place to the another place. Living organism carry out all the metabolic reactions. Thus there are number of properties like the growth, reproduction. By these properties we can differentiate this living organism from the non-living organism. So living organism has such a quality or characteristics which the non-living do not have, and in this topic we are going to focus the important properties of all these living organisms. So we'll see first property of the living organism, and that is called as the growth. So first property of the living organism is the growth. Here there are four important properties of the living organism: growth, reproduction, metabolism and the consciousness. But even though there are the important properties, we say that it is the properties of the living organism, but all the properties are not the defining properties of the living organism. Defining property means what? They are not only related to the living organism. Some of this property has the exception, and that we are going to study in detail in each property. So the first property we call as a growth. Growth is the important property of the living organism because all living organisms show the growth. This growth has two twin characteristics, and these are, the growth can be observed by two things, and these things are the increase in mass, and another one is increase of number of individuals. That means growth of any living organism can be found in two forms. One we call as the increase in mass of that organism, and other form is called as the increase of the number of individuals. Then what is mean by increase in the mass and increase in the number of individuals? See here, if we take the example of the human being, म्हणजे आपला असं सांगता येईल की एखादं लहान मुलाचं जर आपण एक्झाम्पल घेतलं, तर फ्रॉम बर्थ ऑफ दॅट चाईल्ड अप टू देअर अडल्ट स्टेज, इट शोज इनक्रीज इन द मास ऑफ देअर बॉडी, अँड दॅट्स वाय आफ्टर इनक्रीजिंग द मास ऑफ द बॉडी दॅट चाईल्ड अटेन द अडल्ट स्टेज. आणि अशा प्रकारे एखाद्या लहान मुलाची वाढ होते, ग्रोथ होते, त्याच्या बॉडीचं मास इनक्रीज होते, आणि तो नंतर एक अडल्ट म्हणून आपण ओळखतो. दॅट इज कॉल ॲज द ग्रोथ. सो इनक्रीज इन द मास इज वन ऑफ द फॉर्म ऑफ द ग्रोथ. बट इन सम ऑर्गॅनिझम्स, फॉर एक्झाम्पल वी टेक द एक्झाम्पल ऑफ द बॅक्टेरिया. In some organism which we call as a lower organism, which we also call as a initial organism, like in the bacteria, you could take the example like that. This is the bacteria, okay? This bacteria undergoes the process of cell division, and this bacteria divides into two daughter cells. By the process of cell division, this bacteria divide into two daughter cells. Thus there is an increase in the number of individual from this bacteria, but this bacteria increase their number, and that process we call it as a growth. That means here the growth of this bacteria occurs, and that's why it get divided into two daughter cells. So increase in the number of individual in some organism is also the form of growth, while increase in the mass of that organism is also the form of growth. Here we have given the example of the human being, that is increase in the mass, and here we have given the example of bacteria, that is increase in the number of individuals. This growth in all unicellular as well as in multicellular organism takes place by the process of cell division. As you know, here also we have seen the cell division. What is mean by cell division? Any single cell can divide into two cell again divide into four cell again divide into the 8 cell. This is called as the cell division. So in each every living organism, maybe unicellular or the multicellular, this growth takes place by the process of cell division. And we can observe that in the plants, the growth we can see throughout their life. In plant, we can observe their growth throughout their life. For example, from the early stage to the mature stage or to the old stage, we can found the growth in that plant. Plants मध्ये आपल्याला कायमस्वरूपी growth पाहायला मिळते. अगदी ते झाड मरेपर्यंत old होईपर्यंत आपल्याला growth झालेले पाहायला मिळते. But in the animal, growth is not found throughout the life, but it is restricted at a certain age. Animal मध्ये आपल्याला एका ठराविक age पर्यंतच ग्रोथ झालेली पाहायला मिळते. त्याचं एक बेस्ट एक्झाम्पल आपण सांगू शकतो ह्युमन बीइंगमध्ये तुम्ही बघू शकता की वयाच्या 19-20 वर्षापर्यंतच त्या माणसाची हाईट आपल्याला वाढलेली पाहायला मिळते. त्याच्यानंतर उंची वाढत नाही, म्हणजे ग्रोथ ही आहे ती त्या एजपर्यंतच रिस्ट्रिक्ट झालेली पाहायला मिळते. त्याच्या पुढं आपल्याला त्या माणसाची ग्रोथ मग हाईट नसू दे किंवा इंटरनल ग्रोथ असू दे पाहायला मिळत नाही. म्हणजे ॲनिमलमध्ये ग्रोथला लिमिट आहे ॲट सर्टन एजपर्यंत, बट इन प्लांट देर इज नो लिमिट फॉर ग्रोथ. प्लांट कॅन ग्रो अप टू द ओल्ड स्टेज. डू यू अंडरस्टँड व्हॉट आय सेड? ओके, नाव दिस ग्रोथ वी कॅन इझिली ऑब्झर्व इन द युनिसेल्युलर ऑर्गॅनिझम. How we can observe this growth in the unicellular organism? That means in the unicellular organism, if we again take the example of the bacteria, in bacteria which we call as a unicellular organism, in this bacteria we can observe the growth in vitro culture. That means in vitro and in vivo, these are the two terms, in vitro and another term is in vivo. In vitro means outside the body and in vivo means inside the body. That means in vitro culture, that is the outside the body of that bacteria, in the laboratory, by the process of cell division, we can observe that there is an increase in the number of the individual of that bacteria. So we see here that in vitro culture, we can count the number of bacteria which we call as a growth of bacteria, and it occurs particularly by the process of cell division. Again, one important point is there, that is, if we say increase in mass is the characteristics of growth, then that characteristics is also found in the non-living thing. How we can observe the non-living thing also shows increase in mass? There are some examples which can show that non-living organism can also grow by the increase in mass. For example, if we take the examples of mountain, in Marathi we call as a parvat, boulders means big rock, mote dagad, sand mounds म्हणजे वाळूचे मोठे ढिगारे. All these mountains, boulders, sand mounds also shows growth, but their growth is by the deposition of the material on their surface. बाहेरून मटेरियल त्यांच्यामध्ये गोळा होतंय. म्हणजे एखाद्या वाळूचा ढीग जो असतोय त्या ढीग आपण जर वाढवत गेलो तर वाळूचा ढीग मोठा मोठा होत जाणार आहे. म्हणजे देर इज इन्क्रीज इन द मास ऑफ दॅट सँडमॉर्म. ओके, एखादा मोठा दगड आहे, छोटे छोटे दगडाचे पार्टिकल एकत्र येऊन त्याची साईज वाढत जाते. फ्रॉम द एक्सटर्नल ग्रोथ इज देअर अँड दॅट इज कॉल्ड ॲज द इन्क्रीज इन मास. म्हणजे इन्क्रीज इन मास कॅन वी ऑब्झर्व इन नॉन लिव्हिंग थिंग्स ऑल्सो अँड इट कॅन बी फाउंड इन माउंटन बोल्डर अँड इन द सँडमॉर्म. सो इज वन मेजर डिफरन्स इज दॅट द लिव्हिंग ऑर्गॅनिझम शोज ग्रोथ अँड दॅट ग्रोथ इज कॉल्ड ॲज द इंट्रिन्सिक ग्रोथ. While the non-living organism shows growth and that is called as the extrinsic. Intrinsic and extrinsic means what? Intrinsic means that growth is internal and extrinsic means that growth is external. Okay, this is a major difference between the living and non-living. In living thing, growth occurs from inside the body part. In our body, growth takes place from the inside. It's increase in the mass, increase in the number of cells inside our body. That's why in living organism, there is a growth which is due to the internal factor, that is called as the intrinsic growth. In the non-living things, growth is due to the external factors, that is called as the extrinsic growth. Okay, and so we cannot say that growth is the defining property of the living organism. Why? Because there is one exception, and exception is to this non-living things. Even though they are non-living, they also shows increase in the mass of the body, and that's why it is not restricted only to the living organism. Some non-living also shows increase in mass, and that's why growth is called as a not a defining property of the living organism. Do you understand what I said? Growth is not a defining property of the living organism, but it can also found in the non-living thing. So it is not a defining property. Now we'll see the next properties of the living organism, and that property is called as the reproduction. Second one is the reproduction. Reproduction is the property where every living organism can produce the new offspring or new young one which has more or less similar character of their parent. That means here is simply we may say that formation of new progeny from the parent. Formation of new progeny from the parent, we call it as a reproduction. And the progeny or the offspring or the individuals which are formed from the parents showed somewhat similar character of their parents. Not exactly, but somewhat characters of their parents, because you know that this reproduction is of the two types. One type is called as asexual reproduction and other type is called as the sexual reproduction. What is the difference between this asexual and sexual type of reproduction? The major difference is that the asexual type of reproduction do not involve two parents. There is no fusion of the gametes. Only one parent can form the new young one, that we call as a asexual type of reproduction. But in the sexual type of reproduction, you will find that there is the involvement of two parents, male parent and female parent. Male parent produce the sperm, female parent produce the egg, and then there will be fusion of the egg and sperm, that we call as a fertilization, and after that there will be the formation of the new young one, that we call as a sexual reproduction. Then major difference is that this asexual reproduction produce the progeny or the offspring or the young one which are very similar to their parents, exact identical copy of their parents, exact identical copy of their parents. Here we will find, because it is a asexual type of reproduction, only one parent produce similar young one of like that of the parents. But in the asexual reproduction, we find the dissimilar individuals. Dissimilar individual means here, as the two parents are involved, the young ones which are produced from this parent show the characters mixing of the both of parents. This young one has the characters which are the mixing characters of both the parents. That's why these are dissimilar to either one parent, but shows the combination of character of the both the parents. So here the reproduction are of two types, asexual reproduction and the sexual reproduction. Now there are number of examples we can find in every living organism by the different type of process they reproduce, and we say that the reproduction is the important property of this organism. We will see some of the examples where you will find the sexual as well as asexual type of the reproduction. One example is there, that is, for example, you will find that there are some examples like the bacteria. This bacteria, which we call as a unicellular organism, this shows a reproduction by the cell division. That means simply this bacteria divide, okay, and they divide, and at the same time we say that growth as well as reproduction takes place in this bacteria. So cell division is the method of the reproduction in the bacteria. Then another example is the Hydra. The example of the phylum Cylindrata, and the yeast, which is an example of the fungi which we call as a unicellular. In this yeast and fungi, there is the reproduction which takes place by the process of budding, and you are well known about the budding process. See, for example, if this is the yeast, you will find this is the yeast which we call as a parent yeast, because it is the main body of the yeast. On this parent, you will find the small bud is developed here, which we call as a bud. After full development of this bud, after maturation of this bud get detached from this parent plant, it get fall off, and then this small bud again produce similar body like that of the parent. After detachment of this small bud from the parent, this bud produce similar body like that of the parent. So budding is one of the important method which you will find in the yeast, and the Hydra is a type of the reproduction. Another example of the reproduction in lower organism you will find in the Planaria. Planaria is the example of the flatworms, is example of the phylum Flatelementis, which we also call as flatworm because they are flat in size, and this Planaria reproduce by the process of regeneration. Regeneration means what? If we cut, suppose this is the body of the Planaria, and if we cut this Planaria into number of fragments, then what will happen? The each cut part of the Planaria, each cut part of this Planaria will develop the new plant like that of their parents. Each cut part of this Planaria develop whole body like that of parent, and that process of reproduction is called as the regeneration that we will find in this Planaria. Then one more example of the reproduction you will find in the fungi. As we know, this fungi which produce the spores, and that spores are of the asexual type. Asexual spores means what? The spores which are produced only from one parent, whether that parent may be male or that parent may be female. So one parent when produce the spore, then that spore is called as the asexual spore. This fungi at a time produces millions of spores, and this spore all germinate and produce millions of fungi. So you will find everywhere there is a distribution of the fungi because they produce the asexual spore, and this asexual spore formation is a type of reproduction in this fungi, and by which this fungi spread everywhere. Thus there are number of examples you can find in every living organism by which they reproduce. For example, again we will take the example of the algae is algae or some of lower fungi. So there these algae and these fungi also reproduce by the process of fragmentation. Then what is mean by fragmentation? Again, see here, you know the body of algae. For example, in 10th standard you have studied the Spirogyra. Spirogyra is also the one of the example of the algae. See here, these are the Spirogyra. See, which are not observing the Spirogyra under the microscope. By naked eye, you can find the structure of Spirogyra like that. It is a filamentous thread-like structure. If the Spirogyra can be broken down into the different fragments, then you will find that each broken fragments of the Spirogyra later on going to form the complete whole body like that of the pharynx. So fragmentation is a type of reproduction that you will find in this algae. So there are different ways in different living organism, and that ways are called as ways of reproduction by which these living organism can going to form the new young ones, and which we call as a important properties of the living organism. But same like that of the growth, reproduction is also not a defining property. Why? Because in this reproduction there are some exceptions. That means even though there are some living organisms which cannot show the reproduction, and which are those organisms? So there are three examples or exceptions of the living organism which cannot perform the reproduction at all, and these are the mules. In Marathi we call as a khetsar. Mules are the those individuals which are produced by the breeding of the donkey and horse. So it is the two different species come together and there will be formation of mules, and so these mules cannot reproduce at all. Second one is the worker bee, which we call as the sterile worker bee. Worker bee means in honeybee there are three castes: queen, worker and drone. This worker bee, which is the type of the honeybee which cannot reproduce at all, so we call as a sterile worker bee. And third example is that is the human bee, which is also we call as a sterile human bee. Some peoples are there, some couples are there which cannot reproduce, which cannot bear the child. So these are the exceptions to the property of reproduction. We call it as a living organism's property. And due to these exceptions, this reproduction is also not an important properties of the living organism. See here, in today's lecture, we have seen only these two properties of the living organism. One is called as growth and second one is the reproduction. Growth means there are two important characteristics of growth: increase in the mass and increase in the number of individual. Increase in mass means the body mass get increased in some organism, while in some organism the number of young one get increased. That we call as a growth. This growth occur in all living organism by the process of cell division. And in plant you can see the growth throughout their lifespan, but in animal you can observe the growth at certain age. In lower animal like amoeba you can observe the growth in by counting their number in vitro culture, and you can find there is an increase in the number of this individual due to the growth. See here, one important point from this growth is that in this growth, in unicellular organism, growth and reproduction is the same phenomenon. That means growth takes place, which also say that the reproduction carried out in that organism. But in higher plants and animals, growth and reproduction are the exclusive event. That means in higher plant and in higher animal, growth and reproduction are cannot occur at one time. These are the two different phenomena, they occur at the different times. And the last point is that this growth can be also observed in the non-living organism like mountain, boulder, sand mound by deposition of the material over their surface. So we cannot say that it is the defining property of the living organism, because exceptions are there in the mountain, boulder and the sand mound. Second property is the reproduction, which we cannot also say that a living property, because there are some exceptions, and these exceptions are the mules, sterile worker bee and sterile human being. They cannot reproduce at all. This reproduction is of two types, sexual reproduction and the asexual reproduction. In asexual reproduction, you can get exact identical copy of the parent. While in the sexual reproduction, you cannot get identical copy of the parent because two parents are involved and combination of two parents are there in their progeny. So that progeny shows the variation than their parents. This reproduction has a different types. That means we have seen the number of examples. For example, fungi reproduce by asexual spore, planaria reproduce by fragmentation. Again, algae, some mosses, some lower fungi also reproduce by the fragmentation. Then there is also found the sexual reproduction in the human being. So these are the number of examples by which living organism try to reproduce. So in today's lecture, we have completed two important properties of the living organism, growth and reproduction. You can read also the same point from the NCERT, then you can get the idea of how these properties are restricted to the living organism, or how these properties are not, we call as a defining property. Okay, thank you.